Good morning. This morning, I feel like I'm really teaching a class rather than Sunday service, and you'll know why in a minute. I'm going to be talking about the Lotus today, next Sunday, and the following Sunday. And it really is an educational experience, but some of you will not see it as simply educational, but as experiential. So this is what I would like to ask you to think about as I go through the whole process of what a lotus is, what the chalice is, and how it affects us as human being, is not just to understand it intellectually, but also to know that people like myself and others have experienced what it means to have a lotus and experience what it means when these petals begin to unfold. So what I'm saying is that for some people that haven't had an experience, it's strictly, you know, educational. They're learning something or adding to their knowledge. But there will come a time when you're going to have literal experiences and recognition that there is something going on in your human constitution that is affecting changes, and these changes affect your organs, they affect your glands, and particularly the major centers in your body. And when this unfolding process of the lotus occurs, and I was thinking about this today as I was driving over here, I wish we had doctors in the medical profession that understood this, and that when one of their patients came to them, they would understand, say, well, this is what's happening to you. This center is opening. That petal of the lotus is unfolding, and thus it's activating and triggering, you know, this gland and that center and so forth. So I'm still in the process of trying to find people that have had these experiences, and I thought of about 6 or 7 weeks ago that I had found a group that had a doctor that could talk to me about certain things happening, but no, it ends up not the case. So that's still the future. And if you have a son or a daughter or a grandchild that wants to go in the medical profession, tell them to call me. I have all this information that's wonderful, and truly this is information that will describe the process that you're going through, but the medical aspect is missing, the medical element, the phenomena is there, the process that most people will undergo is written there in my compilation, but medically, what do you do? And that's what's missing. There is a most beautiful and mysterious subject in the teaching called the lotus. The lotus is also oftentimes referred to as the chalice. The lotus, the chalice, symbolizes the past. It also symbolizes today, the present. And it also is significant to our future, the future evolution of the soul of each of us. Okay, so the lotus is a seat of self-consciousness. That's self with a capital S. It is the seat of self-consciousness. It is found in the upper levels of the mental plane. And for those of you that know these 7 subplanes of the mental plane, you'll know that it's in the 2nd and 3rd from the top. From the top, 2nd and 3rd of the mental plane. The lotus can be found in the form of a bud. If it's in a bud, then it's the situation for a young soul. In the case of an advanced soul, this lotus will be in full bloom. So from the bud to the full bloom. It is made, this lotus, and this is a good question to think about, even though the abstract, the answer is abstract. It's a good question to ask. Well, okay, if we have a lotus, if there's a chalice, then what is it made from? Well, the teaching tells us that it is made from the substance of the solar angel, and that essentially the lotus has nine petals, but there is also what's called the jewel in the lotus, which is made of three petals. So all total, there are 12. Nine plus three that form the lotus. The lotus is also sometimes called the Holy Grail. So when you read mythology and you read, you know, the history of stories that talk about the Holy Grail, see if there's a symbol behind that word, which would be the chalice, see, or the lotus. Now, this is interesting. Again, this is from the teaching. For ages, the human soul was not yet in existence. Now, this is shocking. You know, this is going to be shocking for those who believe in the soul, not shocking for those who are still trying to determine the soul. Others are trying to determine where in a human being is the soul. So this is going way, way beyond, you know, such thinking. But that's the esoteric teaching. So for ages, the human soul was not even in existence. So what happens to a human being if their soul is not yet in existence? This is where the solar angel comes in. So the human being at that time and place, and still in today's society, there are individuals whose human soul is not yet awakened. So this is where the solar angel comes in. The human being becomes dependent on the solar angel. The job of the solar angel is to make us as human beings into a self-conscious human being. So you can tell people who have no conscience, people who are asleep, people who are not conscious, their soul is not yet in existence. So once that soul comes into an existence, there in that human being, there is a sense of somebody or something greater than themselves, and that's that solar angel. When this happens, there comes a time and place where the solar angel leaves the human being and continues on a path of its own. The physical, etheric, emotional, and lower mental bodies of a person is considered matter, or we in the teachings call it also the vehicles, the physical vehicle, emotional vehicle, mental vehicle, and so forth. These vehicles, or matter, is what for the manifestation of the human soul to come into existence. The first major responsibility of the soul is to take charge over the elemental. See, these are new words for some of us that we haven't heard about before, but I'll tell you, there's something in the mechanism of our nature, in our inner life, that understands it. There'll be a resonance. It's like, well, I haven't read or I haven't studied anything about this, but I know it's right. Okay, so, but now the science of it is that one of the first major responsibilities of our unfolding human soul is to take charge over these elementals. And I'll talk about elementals in a minute. So the lotus is a formation of the on the higher mental plane for the manifestation of the spirit, also called the monad, M-O-N-A-D. It is the lotus which connects the soul to his physical, etheric, emotional, and mental bodies, lower mental bodies, as well as to the soul of the universe, the cosmic magnet. See how this is just rich with so many words and so much information, it's almost hard to assimilate it all at one time. So I suggest you get the the CD or the DVD, either one, and really think about this, that I'm going to repeat this. So the lotus is a formation that takes place on the higher mental plane, which is also called spirit, which is also called monad, for the manifestation of the spirit and the monad. So this lotus is outrageously important to each of us, and we must find ways to protect it. The greater the unfoldment of the petals of the lotus, the more beautiful and the more enlightened will be the human being. When the lotus is still in the form of a bud, the soul has very little control over its physical, etheric, emotional, and lower mental bodies. It's like, perhaps one of the ways to understand this is for a person that can't control their mouth. They just say anything that comes to their mind. They have no control over their speech, no control over their emotion, but they will. See, as this lotus begins to unfold, that bud begins to unfold, and the knowledge petal comes, comes alive, but really it creates a vibration. This vibration is the result of a lot of activity that is going on in the nature of this human being. And pretty soon this bud begins to open, and through the help of the solar angel, and there's a vibration with this knowledge petal. And the person says, gosh, I need to be more responsible for what I say to somebody else, that what I say may hurt them. And then they begin to practice harmlessness. It's really interesting. So there are three stages of awakening that the soul is going to go through. Your unfolding human soul is going to go through. And with each awakening, the petals of your lotus begins to unfold. So awakening, and the lotus begins to unfold. Three stages. The first experience of awakening then becomes part of the resonance of the lotus, or the treasury of the lotus. As the petals of the lotus begin to unfold, which takes many, many ages of experience, it essentially goes through what? The first stage. The first stage is when the soul learns how to take charge of its physical body. If you're not yet in charge of your physical body, you know that your bud is not fully open yet. But again, it will, based on how you live your life. So the first stage is of awakening. The soul learns how to take charge of his physical body. The second stage, the soul begins to control the emotional body and the emotional life. Those who control their emotions are the masters of life. Now, keep in mind, so many people, students in the esoteric teaching, think if they don't show emotion that they're mature. Be careful with that. Be really careful, because all you're doing is stuffing your emotion. When you become in control of your emotion, there is a refinement of the senses that take place, a beautiful refinement of the senses, and your grace increases. When you stuff your emotion, what's happening is that you are crystallizing your heart, and your heart begins to deteriorate and becomes frozen. So those who can control their emotions are masters of life and create such a magnetism that divine energy circulates through them. And I'll talk about the third stage in a minute, but let's talk about the elementals. The physical elemental, the emotional elemental, and mental elemental, three elementals. This reminds me when we have a local health store that I love to go because it's a locally owned health food store, and the woman that owns it is very metaphysically oriented and sensitive. And one day I was in there to get something, and she said, "You know, you need to talk to that little entity that's inside yourself." Oh, she's talking about the physical elemental. That's so cool. Sometimes parents would talk to their children, say, "That's not you, that's George. George might be the elemental, see, that's taking control, rather than the soul taking the control, see, over the physical or emotional body." So it is during these stages that the soul will be challenged to take control of these elementals, of the lower vehicles. The elementals of earth are related to our physical body. The emotional body is related to water, and the lower mental body is related to the air elemental. To cooperate with elementals, we must charge ourselves with the fire of love and the fire of purity, and then fuse ourselves with the solar angel. It's like, what does it mean to fuse yourself? It's like letting your solar angel be your best friend. That's what it means to fuse with your solar angel, that you trust the impulse of your solar angel, that your solar angel gives you advice and you follow it without argument. Your best friend is your solar angel. That's what it means to fuse with your solar angel. Your elementals, and this is so wonderful. I was so excited when I read this in the teaching many years ago, to know that these elementals, George and Harriet and Teddy and so forth, will eventually enter into the evolutionary path through our labor, our human labor, and through also spiritual initiations. Elementals have no form, but they assume form according to the environment, according to the surrounding conditions. Now, the third major stage occurs as our soul awakens and begins to construct the higher mind. Now remember, I said earlier that this takes ages. You know, it's not just an overnight experience. So the third major stage occurs as our soul awakens and begins to construct the higher mind, which is also called the temple. The temple is where our solar angel is anchored. The higher mental body is the temple in our mind. I think it's kind of cool to think about our higher mind as being a temple. The temple consists of the nine petals of the lotus plus the jewel in the lotus, those three other petals. The three innermost petals remain folded for ages and ages and ages, but they are also the energetic sources of the outer nine petals. The jewel will remain folded, but it's there for ages and is the energetic source of the outer nine petals. The jewel in the lotus is the point of the life through which our monad, our spirit, anchors itself upon the physical plane. So the monad is the life principle for all of our, what we call our temporary bodies, our physical body, emotional body, mental body, developed, undeveloped, or developing. In the average person, the lotus is practically non-existent. But as we progress on the path, we develop knowledge, we develop love, we develop a sacrificial nature to some degree. And as we begin to develop these aspects of life, this bud, this small bud, slowly grows and expands and takes the form of what? The lotus. Takes the form of the lotus. For this to happen, the human soul must progress through the three major stages of awakening. The nine fiery petals of energy serve as filters. The nine petals of energy serve as filters for all of our life experiences. Again, this is academic, but let me tell you, pretty soon, as your lotus becomes more active, these petals become more invigorated, more vibrant, you're going to experience the effect. So it's nice to know, as the effects start taking place, that you have the knowledge to know what's happening. So they serve as filters. These nine fiery petals of energy serve as filters for all of your life experiences. What does filter system mean? I was thinking of one of my kids. They talk about their Jesus filter. Well, for the esotericist, we talk about our lotus filter. Okay. These petals filter out the impure and let only the most pure experiences into the temple, our higher mind, letting only the most pure experiences into the temple, forming its treasury. The lotus holds the essence of all of one's pure and real achievements, true knowledge and true service, achievement, knowledge, and service. The nine petals, what's happening is that the nine petals in essence are forming, they fold over into a bud shape over that jewel in the lotus, those three inner petals. Perhaps we could call it the central jewel. When the three innermost petals, this inner jewel, the 10th, 11th, and 12th petals open, then the jewel in the lotus opens and you become the most beautiful spiritual being. It is so beautiful to have knowledge about the spiritual science of the lotus, and to realize that it is up to us. It's not up to mom, it's not up to dad, it's not up to your spouse. It's up to us to take care of this mechanism, to help it to perfect itself so the soul can mature and advance. It brings us a sense of purpose and a sense of future to realize that it is through our striving that certain initiations or expansion of consciousness. Initiation means the same thing. Initiation is an expansion of consciousness. So as we begin to work in ourselves, especially increasing our knowledge, practice meditation, and engage in sacrificial service, not self-serving actions, but sacrificial service, then these initiations begin to take place and our consciousness expands. There are three fires that the teaching talks about that I wanted to throw into this morning's talk. Three fires that as we go through this process of sacrificial service, of striving, of meditation, of increasing our knowledge. Fire by friction takes place. That's the first process which the, I'm trying to put this simply, which the unfolding human soul undergoes. It undergoes a fire by friction. It's an activity which now relates these three permanent atoms to the lotus. The next is a solar fire, which relates to the nine petals. And then we have the electric fire, which relates to the jewel in the lotus, otherwise called will, the will aspect. So it also works wonderfully to know scientifically about this lotus, as well as spiritually, so that as we go through our striving and this process, this whole process, as this lotus, the petals in the lotus begin to unfold, is also called enlightenment. So, you know, for people who don't have all of this, you know, this litany of knowledge, the 1 out of 100 aspects or bullet points of what a lotus is, you know, when they hear the term enlightenment, it means something. Not quite as bullet pointed as, you know, we understand it to be, but it means something. Enlightenment means something to most people. To us, it means a little bit more. Where all actions and all of our achievements are now reflecting principles that we've been taught in the teaching. And these principles are beauty, goodness, righteousness, joy, freedom, striving, and sacrificial service. All of these principles are actions which will be stored in our temple, in the higher mind, and used for future incarnations. This is why we don't have to boast about everything that we have done and given and sacrificed ourselves for, because we're doing it for our evolution, the evolution of our unfolding human soul that's going to be used in future incarnations. See what I'm saying? Most people want to be given attention to everything they do. Some people want to tell every single thing they did for you all day long, all last year, and what I'm going to do for you tomorrow. It's like, okay, go ahead and tell me. But what, you know what they're doing? They're dissipating what they have done. How do you dissipate what you have done? It's through ego and vanity. You're building your ego, you're building your vanity, which is dissipating all that effort that you put into building the lotus, activating those petals, is now dissipating and building your ego and your vanity. It is the lotus which is made of the substance of the solar angel, which builds the pearl, our soul, out of the substance of the monad, endowing it with intelligence and love and willpower. I hate to say this, but I'm gonna, because it's fact. If you're stupid, it means that intelligence, that knowledge petal, is not yet functional. If you are stupid, if you are not intelligent, it doesn't mean that as a human soul you're going to be like this forever. It just means you better get to work. It's time to start building your knowledge. How do you do that? Well, your mom and dad are going to help you with that. It is helpful to know that there, and I'm not, I got to back up a minute, because I need to also talk about not just intelligence, but love and willpower as well. Some people talk about love all the time and they're not loving. some people want love, but because that their heart through events in their life has become frozen, they're incapable of loving. They can't give love and they cannot receive it. What's happening is that the love petals, those three love petals, have been damaged. Okay? And then they begin to atrophy. So it's helpful to know, I'm moving on here now, it is helpful to know that there is a relationship between the petals of the lotus and the three most advanced atoms of your three lower bodies. The physical atom, emotional atom, mental atom, these are the three most advanced atoms in the lotus. It is because of this relationship, whatever occurs in your physical life is passed on to the chalice through the knowledge petals. The knowledge petals will filter out those experiences which are not related to these seven principles: beauty, goodness, righteousness, joy, freedom, striving, and sacrificial service. The pure experience goes into the lotus, and the unfiltered information will be stored in the permanent atom. So the permanent atom stores everything, good and bad, which we then call karma. But what is filtered out is what goes into the treasury. Everything that's pure, your pure intent, pure motive, pure love, pure striving, goes into your chalice. The unfiltered information will be stored in the permanent atom, which the soul will one day meet again. Experiences which created his negative karma or interfered with the evolution of his soul, creating debts which he must now pay for. The other tiers of petals are called the love petals and the sacrificial petals. The love petals work through the astral permanent atom, and pure experiences related to our emotional nature go into the chalice. The sacrifice petals work with the mental permanent atom, and the experiences of value, those pure experiences, are collected in the chalice, becoming the treasures housed in the temple. See how this works? Okay, good. It is the petals of the lotus which lead our three bodies toward more and more refinement. So if you see somebody who is really coarse in their nature, either physically coarse, emotionally coarse, mentally coarse, you know that they're not these permanent atoms. The petals are not filtering out what is good because there's no refinement. I don't know if I'm explaining this clearly. It's like pure intent, pure motive, is what goes into the chalice, and everything that is self-centered is what stays in the permanent atoms, which brings us back into the next lifetime, which then we have to deal with incarnation after incarnation after incarnation. So when people heavily engage in physical exercise, why are you exercising? Is it to build your muscle, or is it to refine your physical body? If it's to build muscle, you're going to come back as a very muscular human being, perhaps however sick, because you haven't refined everything that makes up that physical body. This is why the teachings say don't lift barbells, you know, don't create brute strength. Use the strength of your willpower. Use the strength of the purpose of your life. because that's what goes in to your chalice, into the lotus that is establishing your future. Oh, man, I could really get in trouble. I'm sorry, Mom. I'm probably already in enough trouble, isn't it? All of our thoughts, emotions, and actions are recorded upon our permanent atoms. That the most advanced atoms, right? The physical permanent atom, emotional or astral permanent atom, and mental permanent atom. Basically, the mental unit. Our physical body is rooted in the physical permanent seed, and it is a switchboard of our blood system, nervous system, and glands. Each life, we have a new physical body, but the records are kept in the atom where the various causes of our body are going to be found. Whenever these records are stimulated by the various means, the network automatically begins to work and begins to affect the other bodies. There's an actual network that takes place as a result of what is stored in our physical permanent atom. So whatever records are stored there begins to play itself out from one life to the next, to the next, to the next. And this is why practicality and reasoning oftentimes cannot give us the answer as to what's happening in our life. So, for example, esoterically, the permanent atoms record our debts. A lie, just one little lie. Imagine one of the greatest liars we know about in this country. Okay, sorry, couldn't help it. It's such a good example. So permanent atoms record our debts. A lie is a debt. A theft is a debt. An act of cruelty is a debt. An action that is harmful is a debt. Think about the practice of harmlessness as one of the very first virtues that you should begin to practice as you learn how to talk. In the New Testament, this information is presented in a symbolic parable concerning a debtor who was put into prison and not allowed to be released until he paid all of his debts. These debts are stored in the permanent atoms, the energy that controls the eliminating our cleansing process is called the fire in the lotus. Of course, any act of pure love, pure service, and compassion is a credit and will be collected into the treasury of our temple. It is important to remember that our physical and emotional permanent seeds record all that happens to us. Doesn't make any difference who's watching. Not even Santa Claus. Mm-hmm. Okay. Doesn't make any difference who is watching. It gets recorded. So all that happens to us in our unconscious moments, because most psychosomatic problems have their origin in our emotional permanent atom. Still, the cause of our psychosomatic illnesses are often found and listen to this, all three seeds simultaneously. The permanent atom serves as a nucleus for the distribution of force. Permanent atoms serve as a nucleus for the distribution of force, for the assimilation of experience and the preservation of memory. Now, I'm not talking about what happened last year. I'm talking about the whole history, incarnation after incarnation after incarnation of our soul. In the lotus are found accumulated gifts of higher forces and then later given. Each lofty deed can be marked by the symbol of the lotus. The lotus contains the accumulations of the centuries which are gathered around the seed of the spirit. When a person is developed Any precipitation from the lotus spreads into the three bodies, bringing health and happiness, prosperity, joy, and peace. It is the lotus which relates us to the mundane and supermundane worlds. So I'm going to close with just a little bit more about the love petals in the lotus and their relationship with the other centers in the human being. As the love petals of the lotus unfold, and the reason I want to talk about just for half a minute about these love petals is because we are now in a solar system where all of humanity is being tested with love to become more loving human beings and what that means. It's like there's a book that Torquem Seredarian wrote called The Flame of the Heart. If you want to know what love is about, what it really means, read that book. So as the love petals of the lotus unfold, they create pressure on the petals of the heart center in the head to unfold parallel to the love petals of the lotus. This is where the phenomena that you're going to be experiencing physically, when these love petals, or the one, or the, is the second one, the fifth one, or the eighth one, I have to count through which, because there's a love petal on each tier that begins to unfold. And so you can go through this experience not just once, not just twice, not just three times, but as the fourth tier, that inner level, that love petal that forms the jewel in the lotus, as these love petals begin to unfold, it affects the love center in your head, the pineal gland, also the pituitary gland. And you're going to feel, you're going to have these experiences. We had a meditation this morning where Val was telling us about focusing a few inches behind the shoulder blades, right? Love petal. When you start having activity taking place in that center between your shoulder blades, it means that one of these love petals are unfolding. And then we experience the effect. Not just in the between the shoulder blades, but also in the head. The love petals of the lotus relate a person to humanity. As the love for humanity unfolds, the person feels at one with humanity and shares its joys and sorrows. And in the meantime, turns into a stream of love that pours into the lotus or chalice of humanity. Think of the mother of the world. And I'm not going to say any more, but it ties into what I just said. The petals of the heart center relate a person to a group and react to the group unhappiness or happiness. If you don't give a hoot about your group, then your heart center is not unfolding. The love petal is not unfolding. If, on the other hand, you are registering everything, happiness and unhappiness is going in the group, you know that that heart center, that one of those love petals, has already unfolded. Just the way it is. Group joys or group sufferings affect the heart center, and the person will begin to transcend, their personal love and feel the group love. You have to be strong, emotionally strong, see, to feel this. As the petals of the lotus unfold, they exercise greater pressure for illumination on the cells and atoms of the physical, etheric, emotional, and mental vehicles. These become aligned and integrated and gradually release their latent light, which blends with the light radiating from where? the chalice, that jewel in the chalice, jewel in the lotus. The inner petals of the lotus. So that's it for today.